My name is Ibinyakiyomba Nicholas, and I'm presenting this paper, Integration of Geographic Information Technologies in Management of Institutes in Uganda. I'll be supported by Dr. Mazilidia Kayondo Nandiko and Dr. Yudu Anthony. I've given an outline of my paper, which has a background up to the conclusions and recommendations. Now, the background of this paper is that road transport in Uganda carries over 90% of passenger and freight traffic. This is according to UNRWA. In this paper, I will be giving an integration of how we can have, you know, geographic information technologies cut across the maintenance of roads in Uganda. So I'm giving a background to this. The road network in Uganda, shares importance, carries an average of 4 million passenger kilometers per year, compared with 9 million passenger kilometers by air and 6 million passenger kilometers by water, and almost none by rail in this country, according to Mutabazi. And further to that, the network of Uganda is composed of 21,500 kilometers of national roads, 22,500 of the district roads, 4,500 of municipal roads, 4,500 of urban roads, and 30,000 kilometers of community access roads. Now, apart from the national roads, the rest of the roads I've mentioned are really local government roads. It is the local governments which maintain those roads. Now, there are various initiatives in which the geographical information technologies have been used to collect and manage data for maintenance decision support in this country of ours, Uganda. Now, when we talk about geographical information technologies, these essentially include four technologies of geographical information systems, global positioning system, remote sensing, and web-based tools such as Google Earth for sharing information and visualizing of near real-time data. I'm sure in many previous presentations you've heard about this. Now, geographical information, as mentioned by Mazzi, once collected, managed, and analyzed using geographical information technologies, it supports and simplifies decision making for road infrastructure maintenance to a non-technical level, whereby maps, and as you heard from previous speakers, now dynamic maps are even generated to support decision making. But why are maps important? The World Center has outlined that maps, GI, that is geographic information, can be used to generate maps, which are powerful tools. We all know that maps orient, they guide, they provide a sense of scale and distance, and a universal language accessible to people from different personal, professional backgrounds. Now, in the transportation planning context, maps are used to communicate important information, such as the location of structures and conditions of roads at large. Now, what was the problem that I observed before carrying out this study? Now, whereas there has been a huge investment in introduction and adoption of geographical information technologies in Uganda's local government, it is this local government which maintain a huge network of roads, there is lack of information on the extent to which the adoption of the geographical information technologies in the road sector of Uganda's local government had progressed, resulting into improved roads management. So there is a great gap. This study sought to assess the competences of district engineers and road work supervisors, who are really the managers of these roads, on the use of geographical information technologies in road maintenance, ascertain the challenges faced by local government road managers, and establish a conceptual framework that is suitable for effective adoption of the GITs in that sector of roads management. Now, I identified and developed three objectives. One, to ascertain the extent to which these managers in local governments use GITs to prepare and share inventory maps of district road networks. Secondly, to establish the extent to which roads managers and local governments use the GITs, that is GIS, the application of the best applications, you know, to the extent they use to assess, present, and share the condition of roads and structures. Because of this useful information in management of roads. And eventually, to develop a conceptual framework that was suitable for effective adoption of the GITs, the road sector of Uganda's local government. Now, I developed a methodology, and And this methodology, it identified the methods together with the justification and eventually the output. Now, in the methods I used, there was a combination of literature review, use of questionnaires, interview guides, and the store research. And the justification for each of these was identified, and the output was identified to be to gain an overall understanding of DIGs and their importance local government in the local government road sector, the extent to which the DIGs had been adopted and known, and also the conceptual framework for the adoption of the technologies, and eventually the challenges and remedies to adopt the DIGs. Now, I identified variables, matched them with objectives, and eventually I wrote the research questions in my study. The independent variable in this case was the ability to use the geographical information technologies. And here I focused on the ability to use the GPS, GIS, and sharing data via web-based applications. Now, the dependent variables were the ability to generate roads inventory data, the inventory maps, and share them. Sorry. Another dependent variable was the ability to generate roads condition data, because it's one thing to get the inventory of the network, and it's another thing to get the condition of the network, the structures of the network, and the condition of the structures on the network. So it is this ability that I was looking for from the road managers, and this applies to each of the objectives 1, 2, and 3, and the subsequent research questions were developed. Now, the methodology I used, I identified the following components. One, defined the research design, and this was both qualitative and quantitative. The study area, I focused on districts in northern Uganda and central Uganda, because over the years, many projects have been introduced in Uganda, and many of these projects have had a component of use of DIGs in management of roads. But it is northern Uganda and central Uganda that have got the most expertise in learning about the DIGs because of the different components of the different programs. And these projects were supported by Danida, the Danish Development Agency, New Delhi, and JICA by the Japanese. Now, the data collection method I used was use of questionnaires, interviews with key informants, and desktop research. My population was 81 district roads managers. And these are essentially the district engineers and the district roadwork supervisors who are the managers of the roads in local governments. The data collection was analyzed using the software startup. So my study area was a combination of northern Uganda and central Uganda, like I've explained. The eastern and western were left out in the scope of this study. Now, in my methodology, to look at the integration of the GIGs in my study, I looked at the competencies that these managers should have in order to adopt the use of the DIGs in the management of district roads. And the competencies were, one, basic use of equipment. And this equipment, and under this I was basically looking at setting of the GPSs for field use, tracking and capture of points and tracks, setting of the computers for GIS use. Now, another competence I sought for in my study was basic software use. I may use the word basic because the engineers and supervisors work for managing the roads. GIGs are not their first priority of learning, but they are adopting and using these technologies to enable them to carry out their work with maintenance. So under basic software use, I was looking at their knowledge of the applicable software, downloading of data to their computers, data pre-processing, post-processing. Now, under the preparation of maps, I focused on the generation of the spatial data, the generation of the road inventory maps, road thematic maps. The thematic maps, we're looking at the different interests of road management, like condition of drainage, condition of the surface, the condition of the shoulders. The structures inventory maps, where we have the structures, culverts, can you locate where we have the bridges and the different, you know, kinds of structures. And also, the condition of these structures. Now, another competence I sought from these people was the ability to share their maps. And here I focused on the printing of maps, exporting to camera format, and geotagging of the photos. Now we got some results. One, that the occupation and its space of the people I'm looking at, I was able to categorize it into the different years they've been able to work with the maintenance of roads. And if you can see from the results, the district engineers and the supervisor of works presented, the majority of the district engineers at least have been occupying those offices for more than 14 years. Now it is over these years that the different donors and government programs have run in the road sector to introduce the DIGs. So as we look at the further results, we need to be able to understand that these people have really been exposed to these trainings over the years. These DIGs, which I mentioned earlier on, were documented in manuals. And these manuals have been made available to the district engineers as well as the methods of training. And really, up to 60% declared that they had got access to the RAMS EPS mapping manual. RAMS is an habitation and maintenance planning system developed by the Ministry of Works. And 35% had access to the JICA mapping and database manual. But also there is a fraction of some, up 5%, who have declared that they've not had any access to those manuals. Now in terms of software used for the district roads management, and what we've been hearing from the start of this world and conference, the districts are using fairly old software. Now, up to 35% of the district roads managers don't have access to any software to use management of roads, and really that is absurd. But 28% can use MapSource, ArcView, 31% MapSource, you know, combined with ArcGIS, 3%, and a combination of several other software, 3%. So you can really see that apart from the 35% who have no access to any software, the others have got the subsequent software access. Now in terms of the roads inventory database, up to 59% of the engineers are only using Excel, and they don't have any better database management solution that is for management of roads. Now in terms of the objectives, I look at their ability to download GIS data from the GPS after setting, tracking, and capturing the GPS data along the roads. Because we are interested in tracking the roads and also picking key points, you will observe that 6% say they cannot execute that, but up to 94% are either completely able or can do it with some support. When it comes to the ability to download also the same data in terms of the important points, I focus on the points because many of the structures along roads will be picked as points. Whether it's a bridge or a culvert or a drift, will be picked as a point. And up to 5% were not able to do that. But now that they are 95% were able to do that. Now, in terms of the software that is being able to process some shape files, you know, this we are still talking about the level of processing shape and shape files. We are aware that in terms of DIGs, we have advanced well into using other systems in managing special information. But at this level, the district engineers in local government, we are still talking about our shape files. And a portion of up to 20% are not able to process this data via our shape files. Now, in terms of their ability to share the processed district road network maps via the web-based applications, you will observe that a single percentage of them can do that, and not many are really able to do that. Now in terms of the tabular aspect, when it comes to sharing this information, up to 38% are not able to share the special information they have generated because of lack of skills. The table is quite detailed, but I'm giving a summary of that. Now in terms of their ability to prepare and export GIS layers to Google Earth, maybe by use of the camera format, a whole 85% are not yet able to do this. So only 50% are able to share this information via the web of what they have generated. Now in terms of geotagging or photos for sharing, also via the smart applications, only 18% are able to do this, and others still have a challenge. Now in terms of sharing maps by being able to print and share, the district engineers, 62% were able to print and 38% were not. Yet on the other side, they ask as well as providers of works, it is the contrary. A whole 62% are not able to process and share a printed map. Now, there are many challenges which are being about this, and from my study, the biggest challenge was one, lack of knowledge and training use of DIGs. The ministry and the relevant departments have a training school at Mbale, Mount Elgon Training Center, And through this, they got trainers, and these are full-on training. The different leaders in doing this. But up to 50% of the respondents are still lacking knowledge in terms of using EITs. Lack of hardware is another, poor access to the software, shortage of manpower, there are complaints about the funding capacities, policies are not harmonized in terms of what the Minister of Works is asking for and what the road fund, where the owners of the money, what they're asking for. We have different reporting systems. There are also issues of either no power at all or irregular power, and also the internet lacking is a serious issue, a challenge for this. Many solutions have been identified from the study, and really they are responding to the problems that were listed previously. Now, in terms of the conceptual framework, I integrated the different issues that I identified in the challenges to the adoption of the EITs. And indeed, when you look at the ways attached to each of these, training, hardware, right software, access to the internet, power, funding, and also the regulatory model or the policies were important to build up a case whereby we have our staff being able to collect spatial data, process the spatial data, create maps, and eventually share the maps. Because if these are done in the framework, we shall have the full adoption of the DITs, because it's what is expected of them, the decision of their work. In my conclusion, I realize that in terms of, in line with the first objective, only 48% of the district managers, and that is the leaders as well as the works, were able to prepare maps. And only 28% could share the inventory maps of the district roads. Inventory, we are talking about the stock of the roads they have under their management. These are the custodians of the network in the areas of the jurisdiction, but only 48% can use DITs to at least give a comment of that. Now, in terms of giving some detail further, because if you have a network, where are the structures? What is their condition? How can you integrate this data into one database and use it for further analysis and planning for Uganda? Only 60% could capture the GPS data for the changing conditions of the roads and their structures, but only 37% were able to prepare the condition maps and share them. Now, further than that, only 15% were able to produce thematic GIS layers. Because when we talk about thematic GIS layers, there are areas of interest we may be looking at. For example, what quantity of ground we have in Uganda? That question may never be easily understood or answered until we can prepare our safe thematic areas of our country. And further to that, 18% of these were able to geotag and export photos. Yesterday we were looking at in the presentation here. You should be able to pick a photo and post it to a web and put it to use with the location, but only 18% were able to do that. So in my conclusion, we still have a low adoption of the graphical information technologies in the road sector of Uganda's local government. The use of the DITs is in its infancy, with only 50% of spatial data collected and processed for district roads of Uganda. The available data is not yet used to improve the management of roads in this country. We are still collecting and collecting and collecting. I've put some recommendations. One, and these recommendations are coming under three categories. One, the local government roads managers, those who are doing the management of the network. Two, to central government, and third, the donors who have pumped in the resources we've used in this whole sector. One, the managers, we need to build capacity in the use of DITs. I've not seen any district engineer here. I think if they had come here, they would have really learned much. Because well, they are still struggling with ActiveView, MapSource, what we have many open source software which are really in play. People are busy writing vouchers, requesting for licenses, but I can see that many other options can take on. Also, we need to budget for the budget and acquire the right hardware, because these are not controllers. They can only vote for what they want to do. But I need to do that. Then also, we need to recruit as per the establishment. Because in every district, you should have a district engineer and a district road work supervisor. But when I was doing my survey, it was realized that in many districts, there's only one person occupying both offices. Now, central government still needs to do the capacity building in the use of DITs. I interacted with many key informants, including the trainers and trainers. But from what I have seen here, I think their capacity goes so far below the required. So I don't know what the passing number is saying. Now, in terms of, we also need to streamline the use of DITs in the management of local government roads. We still have a collision between the road fund and the Ministry of Works and Transport. They need to put clear what they want to do and how it should be done using DITs. There is an option of using open source software. Of course, it can be by licenses, but I don't see this understood by many of the role players as I said. We need to access and integrate free available data. We need to look at the SDIs, and also we need to harmonize policies to allow similar broad management systems between the different agencies. Data sharing, so government should look at it closely, locally, nationally, to reduce the risk of duplication, because we find many small donors that are doing the same work, yet there is one owner of the roads in this country. That's Ministry of Works. The Minister should also speak a data center. I visited them many times. There was one when the headquarters were still in Entebbe, but when they shifted to Port Bill Road, it is alleged that the computers disappeared. So they went back to nothing. Now they're collecting again. Now the donors, 50% of special data has been collected over 10 years. We need to do more, we need to conclude this and begin using the data for the management of roads. We talk about money, we are talking about inventory, condition assessment, planning, reporting. Surely if we got that done, you can see the different conditions of our roads. They'll change from one condition to better condition in this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nicholas, for the presentation. I've been made to understand that Nicholas is a master's student and he hasn't submitted. So when we are giving comments, let us put that into consideration. If there are any comments which can improve his work before he submits, welcome. Any comments?
Thank you so much. I have a couple of comments. Is it possible to map? You know, you're talking about number of engineers and stuff like that, the local government and things like that. One, what is the justification for you using a sample size of 81? Does it make statistical sense? Two, is it possible for you to give us a presentation or a visualization of the roads that you're dealing with? Are you dealing with all roads or just the major roads? Or, okay, what roads are you talking about? Those that are come up, those that are, you know, bigger roads that didn't come up clear.
Maybe let us take another question before your response. There's a hand here, the hand on the right hand side.
Thank you so much, Nicholas. My name is Dale from Delta Green. My concern is about the cost. If you consider the cost of training an engineer to do all this software, preparing of maps, sharing, geotagging, and so on. The cost in terms of money, but also in terms of time. Isn't it cheaper to recruit another person to do this work for the engineer who already has his engineering works on his table?
Thank you. There's a hand. There are two more hands. One in the middle, then one in front here. Just in front, and also in the middle. Then you respond to the questions.
Thank you, Nicholas. In your sample, you had engineers from northern Uganda, and then those from central Uganda. But in the discussion of your results, I did see you teasing out the differences between maybe those from the northern region and those from central region. I think maybe the concentration of those who said yes to some of the questions would
isn't he going to
by the region, just the thought. Because then number two, about the competences that you saw the activities, those questions you had, is that the whole list of the competences that are required of these engineers, up to what level will you say, yes, now this one is okay and it's ICT and GIT compliant? Is it 100%? At what level would you consider an engineer to be okay? Thank you.
Okay, let us have the comments or questions in front.
Thank you, Engineer Jemba, for your presentation. From your results, you indicate a lot of problems in management of the road network, especially on the conditional assessment. My question is, do you think your results did help put the current judicial commissioner inquiry to the mismanagement of what's the design?
Let us give him time to respond to those. I think I will most likely I'll have some more means for the next set of questions. Yes, Nicholas, you can respond to those.
I'll do my best to give the answers where I can. The first question was about being able to map. Is it possible to map the number of engineers in the region? And the justification for the 801. Well, where were these 81 coming from? The study area, which was northern Uganda and central Uganda, had 54 districts in northern Uganda and 30 districts in central Uganda. So those are expected to have at least two people per district, that is the district area, the supervisor works. But on closer examination of the staffing levels at each of the districts, the manpower was far less than that. So from the population that was available, the sample that was derived from the existing manpower in those areas was only the 81 coming out of the people occupying offices and running that assignment, those districts. So that's how that number was derived. Because again, it's a lot of background. From the actual occupants of those places, from the actual occupants of the offices in the area of study. And why Northern and Central Uganda, looking at the different programs that have been introducing or encouraging the adoption of EITs in this country, Nodale, JICA, Dadida. It is these two areas of Central and Northern that have been most exposed to the trainings in EITs. So the measurements I'm giving, we're giving the best example of what we're expecting in Uganda. Now, there is the second question of what roads are we talking about. Now, the roads we're talking about, I gave a quick understanding of the kind of roads you have in Uganda. In Uganda, we have the following categories of roads. Paragraph 3. The network of Uganda is composed of 21,700 kilometers of national roads. Now, these national roads are the ones which are managed by the Uganda National Highways Authority, based here in Nakasero. 22,500 kilometers are district roads, and these are managed by the district local governments, the districts Kabarole, Kumi, Sorochikuru. Now there are 4,500 kilometers of municipal roads. The municipalities are talking about Fort Porto, Yaguru, and 4,500 kilometers of urban roads. There are a few urban roads, a few kilometers in the other small towns, and 30,000 kilometers of the community access roads, which others call Wundiwansi. Now, my study focuses on the 22,500 kilometers of roads which are directly managed by the district of government engineers and supervisors of works. So I hope that has come up now here. These are essentially ground roads. I think in Uganda we only have about 1 or 2 kilometers of tarmac district roads. I think it's somewhere in Rakai, which was done by the leader. But the rest are these ground roads you see in this country, which are feeding onto the gravel national roads, or they're really feeding through the tarmac national roads.
Now, in terms of the cost of training an engineer vis-a-vis recruiting other people to come and do this bit of work, that is not appropriate. Because we want these technologies to be integrated, to be adopted into the day-to-day business of the engineer. When the engineer is doing roads management, when you talk about roads management, this overlaps with a bit of the next question. When you talk about managing roads, we are talking about being able to take stock of your roads. How many kilometers of roads are you managing? You, the engineer of CAC. That can be answered using DITs. Inventory of roads. Let the engineer use the DITs. Not have another expert come and answer that question. What is the condition of your roads? Should you be able to break down the network into sections, use DITs and answer that question. 30% of my network is good as per the specifications of the ministry. 40% is poor and 20% is very bad. No, because if another person is answering for the engineer that question, then the engineer is not relevant. So we want him to adopt and integrate these technologies into the routine business of his operations. But there is also now the other issue of recruitment as the establishment. I'm not yet aware of the Ministry of Public Service allowing the recruitment of these other people to come and, you know, and work with these people. The engineers are doing this work and they should be equipped with the technologies to execute their work. There was another question of at what level will someone be okay to be sure that he's being called 100% of being in compliance. I've given the scale. Can you do the inventory? Can you do the condition assessment? Can you plan with available resources? Can you give us a work plan? Can you report on your work plan using DITs? Can you develop the maps for each of those levels I talked about? Can you share them? And lastly, can you update at the frequency required? And I think at this time, we're talking about updating annually. District roads are becoming national roads. Community access roads are becoming district roads. So you should be able to change the attributes, you know, with your files and update one central area. That's what you're talking about. Thank you very much, please.
Yeah, I have some 2 minutes, but then the last question, I think you have not touched it. From
the judicial. Yes. I'm not an authority on answering questions with inquiries, but I'll try to give an example to sort out this. From the questions raised by the Judicial Service Commission, there have been many questions, there have been many issues around figures not tallying. So if you can use DITs to do analysis, if you had the data on roads and would analyze it, I'm sure we'll not be having issues like compensating people for 100 kilometers along the road of 60 kilometers. So with quick analysis, I think we should be able to give relevant answers to sort of many of the messes which can help the people in the Judicial Service Commission. So maybe we should have the DIS analyzing many of these issues in the commission and giving answers, cross-checking what either they are giving or telling what they are giving. That's my imagination. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have two slots, one from the participants and one from the panel here. Who wants to take up that one slot? Yes, there's a hand there. As we wait for him, we can have the question from the panel.
Thank you very much for the very interesting presentation. I have a comment. Allow me to show you a solution, maybe with a 1 or 2 minutes video just before my presentation, which will give you a lot of answers and ideas how you can bring at least half of these figures very quickly up. Thank you. Otherwise, it's really very hot topic, I think, the presentation that you did.
Okay, that's a suggestion to improve your work so you will be very attentive when presenting. Yes, let us have the last question.
Okay, my worry is about who consumes the products that is started. Suppose Dr. Musum has actually started and asking, can the judicial commission actually use the results of your study for their own work? So it means we need to focus on your study per se and look at its results and see who does it benefit. Because the problem seems to look at these investments are being done into the GIGs, but unfortunately they are not being used. But so what is the actual problem that arises from that, and who is interested in that part? Is it the government that they are worried about over-investing into something that does not work? Is it the ministry itself? I would like to really get more
interested because this is the
real result.
Himself, he should be interested because he's a state.
Thank you. Nicholas, you have any comments?
You are not sure.
Who would want to use my results, my findings? Yes, in my company, I've said that we still have a low adoption of the technologies. But when you review literature from what's happening in the region, in Africa and around the world, these technologies are being used in many parts of the world. All local governments are really using GITs in management of their facilities, management of their systems. And Uganda, I've only said we are at the infancy of doing this. We are still talking around something. But I know sooner or later we shall come out of it when we let people know of the advantages of this. But like I said, the problems around this, as we build the capacity, we've had issues of manpower shift, we've had issues of people leaving offices, and we've not had a consistent transfer or adoption of these technologies. But if it can be instituted into policy, that for the maintenance of our roads, we need to have these tools adopted, I think our government itself realizes the benefits and will further promote the use of these technologies in the management of roads. So we need to continue the advocacy of getting people to know that we really have this capacity and can be adopted and be used for the benefit of the management of roads. Thank you very much.
Yes, Nicholas, thank you for presentation. But before we leave you to go, I think the many comments have come from the panel and also from the participants. Some have not been answered very well. So since you haven't finalized, please note those comments. And especially on your last specific objective, and this is where most of the questions are coming from, of developing a framework. The framework you have is not very conclusive and not very clear. And it was clear most of the questions, actually, the last questions would have been addressed by the framework you are suggesting, where you included visual issues, who is actually going to use, how do you put it in use. But let us thank Nicholas for what he has presented.